A new form of subjectivity is emerging today that I find fascinating. The subjectivity whose most visible effect are video games. Don't underestimate video games. I think that first we have 20th century cinema. Now we are in an era of maybe TV series as typical. I claim next decades will be of video games. Are you aware how important they are? Are you aware that already for 3 years, video games turn around more money worldwide than cinema and TV series combined? What interests me here is how they affect our sense of subjectivity. If you played them, I didn't, I'm too stupid, you have to press fast, but my son does and I observed him often. This new form of subjectivity is something very interesting. It's an undead subjectivity, a subject which is open to the unending cycle of dying, resurfacing, and so on and so on. Just think about cartoons. You remember Tom and Jerry and those. It's the same magic universe. You remember, like Tom or Jerry, cat mice, it's run over by a truck, flattened, cut into pieces. No problem. In the next scene, it's again here. You can begin again and again. You know who was the author of this, the first who articulated this fantasy? As far as I know, it was Marquis de Sade. This is how victims like Juliet in his novels function. They are endlessly tortured in multiple ways, but magically they survive their ordeal and in the next chapter they return fresh and so on. So my point is that this also explains another aspect of video games, of our civilization, which is, and it's very important phenomenon, I claim. I don't have time to develop it, how it began with Kant. Kantian, Immanuel Kant. Idealism opened up the space for it. Something which we call today undeadness. You know, all these phenomena, I call it obscene immortality. All these figures of persons whose tragedy is not that they die, but that they cannot die. They always return. Vampires, undead, and so on. Ah, to amuse you with an important philosophical reflection, let's risk a little bit of philosophy. You know why Kant, Immanuel Kant, opened up the space for it? It's a very simple element, but crucial. In his theory of judgment, Kant distinguishes three types of judgment. Positive, affirmative judgment, negative judgment, and infinite judgment. In a positive judgment, you assert a predicate. In a negative judgment, you deny a predicate. But in what Kant calls infinite judgment, you don't deny a predicate, but you assert a non-predicate. Now you will say bullshit, it's the same. It's not, I will prove it to you. And I refer here to your knowledge of Stephen King and all those authors. Let's say he is dead. No ambiguity here, he is dead. You assert a predicate. Let's negate the predicate. He isn't dead. It means he's alive, no problem. But let's not negate the predicate, let's assert a non-predicate. Instead of saying he isn't dead, let's say he is undead. Undead means something different. It doesn't mean he is alive. It means he is alive as dead. He is a living dead. This third space is open, which is precisely the space of evil ghosts, zombies which haunt you, and so on. It's the space of something that I like to call obscene immortality. We have this good ethical immortality. In your works, you will live forever, forever. Goodness cannot die. But we tend to forget that we also have this obscene immortality, like that of zombies and so on, where evil persists, beyond life and death. It cannot die, it returns forever. And my point being, isn't this situation exactly the situation of video games? You know, you get engaged into a fight, you drop dead, usually you have 5-10 lives, or in some games, infinite lives. No problem, you drop dead, you just begin again. This infinity. Now you will say, but this is fiction. It's more complex. It's a certain attitude of, I can run back in time, I can return to the starting point and begin again and again, which I claim more and more determines our daily experience. Like some of my friends, I caught them treating their life game as a their love life as a video game. Like, I try with this girl or man or whatever, it didn't work, let's return back, let's start again with another one or whatever or whatever. So, this type of subjectivity is a very obscene one because it's undeadness, but again, not the noble immortality, but an obscene immortality where what in psychoanalysis we would have called symbolic castration, the awareness of our basic finitude, mortality, is abolished. Now, okay, let's go to the next step now. I hope for some of you things will get a little bit more amusing. Now you will probably tell me, but wait a minute, this is nonetheless a virtual universe. In reality, it doesn't work like this. Ah, here I would like to complicate things a little bit. I claim that our what we call reality is much more paradoxical, in the sense that we cannot clearly distinguish real reality and virtual reality. Our reality that we see around us, for it to have sense, it has to be always supplemented by a virtual element, which is why maybe some of you know this text of mine. I wrote a text of a wonderful game, not wonderful in the sense that I'm ready to lose 1 minute playing it, but philosophical consequences, I hope you know it, Pokemon Go. I think it's pure game of ideology. You know what happens? It's no longer escape from real world to virtual world. You look through the screen of your apparatus at real world. You see reality the way it is, but you see something more, the Pokemon. And that triggers your desire. That makes reality consistent. You have confused reality, you don't know what goes on there. Pokemon, the figure, added to reality, reality becomes something meaningful and so on. This is why I proposed a thesis that the greatest practitioner of Pokemon Go was Adolf Hitler with his anti-Semitism. Isn't the figure of the Jew exactly such a Pokemon figure? In what sense? You look, if you're a German, at reality in 1931-32, boring, chaos. Then Hitler comes and say, but look for the Jew. And it becomes interesting, everything acquires meaning, and so on and so on. And I think that this is the future. Why? Because my point is that the trick with Pokemon Go is not that it's something new. No, it brings out something which was always already here in our ideological life. Ideology always works as augmented reality. You think you see reality, but not a Pokemon digital machine, but your ideology. Our ideological apparatus is the big Pokemon machine. Look, again, let's say you are a racist. You walk along the street, you see an Arab, a Jew, and so on. If you are a racist Pokemon image, you will see the Jew or the Arab as this threatening Pokemon figure. Oh, is he a rapist, is he whatever, and so on and so on. So again, we should absolutely be aware that the way we see reality is not a neutral, innocent reality. It's always augmented reality. And this is crucial. This is, I think, the big result for me, not only of Pokemon, but also of other video games and so on, that the future is no longer just, again, virtual reality. That's the terrifying, but at the same time, almost beautiful thing about it. It's not just you escape from real life, you just live on the screen. No, the promise is you remain in real life. And that real experience of real life is already augmented through some imagined elements. And this, again, this is ideology.